Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Digital Asynchronous class. So for today, you should have read the first chapter out of Dave's ethnography, Queer Activism in India. And I was Googling queer activism in Delhi, and I came up with this gem of a picture. I'm here, I'm queer, and full of existential fear. So today, the introduction is really, of course, laying out the argument and the theoretical frameworks. I'm going to unpack some of the concepts that Dave is introducing and using as integral to their project. But maybe I'm hoping that this book might be a nice lighter touch after Sean Jay and Simpson's books, because we're all, based on that last conversation, we're all maybe need something that's a little more hopeful. Not that I don't think there's hope in refusal, but Dave is going to give us a framework for talking about queer activism and the cultivation of radical new worlds. So Dave's book is based on an ethnography of queer and particularly lesbian activism in Delhi, working with Kaleri, or the Campaign for Lesbian Rights in 1999, and then once that organization essentially becomes defunct, working with PRISM, or People for the Rights of Indian Sexual Minorities. And as Dave observes, these organizations are spaces of ongoing debate over what should queer politics look like? What kind of world are they trying to bring about? What is the goal? What should they be doing? Constant back and forth, evaluating, critiquing, and creating programs for how to do this work. Those debates are described in page 4. These are grassroots organizations, right? Dave describes PRISM as resolutely non-funded. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Resolutely non-funded. They are not just underfunded, they are not seeking funding because they are organizing and they want to have the autonomy that comes from not being beholden to funding organizations. And so what this book is really about is thinking about queer activism in Delhi in terms of the ways in which in which queer activists critique the world in order to imagine spaces of possibility and open spaces of possibility. This is what they call an ethnography of ethics or ethical practice. And basically, the kinds of organizing drive or question of the book is this quote from page 2, which is that they're investigating this tension within activist circles between, on the one hand, a sense of enormous possibility, a new social world becoming, and on the other hand, a sense of closure, potential seemingly realized, questions now answered, indeed, of where do we go now? So how do we make sense of this tension between a sense of possibility and a sense of closure? And this is really at the heart of queer activism in India, according to Dave. So Dave's core argument is really outlined on page 3. Basically, they are arguing that queer activism is an ethical practice that has three components, right? There's three stages of it. There's critique, or the problematization of social norms. The second step is invention, the invention of new norms. And the third step is creative practice, the creation of newly invented, po the creative practice of these newly invented possibilities. Now, so when we get at this kind of argument, right, there's a couple basic concepts at the core of their argument, which I'm going to unpack throughout this presentation. There's the ethical, and there's affect. One of the points that is really important to underscore at this point is their argument that when, even though they're talking about the ways in which queer activists critique and problematize social norms and invent alternatives, create and open emergent spaces for novel possibilities. Even though that's what they're interested in, right? Dave is saying norms are not the other to ethics, nor is closure the other to potentiality. Instead, these aren't binary oppositions for Dave. Instead, they're deeply entangled and intertwined with one another. As they write on page 3, limitations are the very condition of possibility for once unthinkable social emergences, like queer activism in India. So the idea, right, is that norms, this is, I just really like the language. They're so beautiful with words. They're such a good wordsmith. She is such a good wordsmith. But, right, limitations, closure is not the other to potentiality. It's not in binary opposition to potentiality. It's the condition of possibility for new, once unthinkable social possibilities to take shape, to emerge. Likewise, norms are not in binary opposition to ethics. Rather, norms are the conditions from which ethics can emerge from as a critique of norms. Yet also, ethical practice for Dave is fundamentally about this ongoing practice of inventing and practicing new norms, a creative practice, an inventive practice, and then also critiquing a kind of cyclical process of then having to critique those norms. This is a always unfinished process for Dave. So a couple terms too that I'm not getting into in the PowerPoint as much, but are probably worth defining because of the way Dave uses them, right? When Dave is thinking about this tension between limitations and possibility, closure and potentiality, they use words like emergence and imminence. Basically, imminence, or something, if something is imminent, it means it's on the verge of becoming manifested. It's on the verge of becoming real. It's not quite actualized, but about to be actualized. Emergence is a framework that basically talks about this process of becoming in a similar way, but saying, and so, to say that something, a social phenomenon, is emergent means nobody really defined it, no one's decided to create it. It's a set of possibilities that you would say that it's social possibilities that are emergent within social conditions. It's this process of becoming possible, of taking shape in a very horizontally organized way. That's not necessarily. Well, no, I don't want to go that far. We'll just leave it there. So these are some words that Dave uses. And I have a meme for you from basically this kind of division that Dave is underscoring or is creating in order to put forward this argument is the difference between morality and ethics. Now, if you go to a philosophy course, you'll probably get a different morality and ethics definition, but for Dave, what we're talking about in this book in the context of queer activism, morality has to do with the norms for proper gendered sexual and familial comportment. Basically, morality is about heteronormative norms or social norms about how to be properly gendered and sexual or properly in a family. The proper, what do they call it in the US? The traditional family, that kind of conservative discourse. Versus ethics. And for Dave, ethics is the undoing of social moralities. It's the undoing of heteronormativity. It's the undoing of these kinds of taken for granted norms in order to create spaces otherwise, in order to create radical new worlds. So the first concept that's underlying Dave's argument is this concept of ethics. And to build out their argument, they're drawing on a French philosopher, Foucault's distinction between judicial and aesthetic ethics, which I'll get into in a moment. But I have this meme for you, right? Who would win? The progressive narrative of modernity, which underpins mankind's faith in the structures that make up Western society, or one baldy boy? Baldy boy is Foucault, is this French philosopher. Apparently, it's a stupid meme, but apparently if you Google Foucault memes, you get shit like this. And actually, I think this meme is kind of interesting for the purposes of this class, right? Because what it's doing, right, it's esoteric. This is like you have to have a lot of background in French philosophy to get the joke. But basically, Foucault is known for critiquing the kinds of structures of progress, and the narratives of progress and modernity that underlie the way that underskirts the ways that we imagine the West or the modern. He has books critiquing the history of the construction of sexuality as pathology, which ultimately was a liberal project, right? In which you have scientists, psychologists, and sexologists who say, you know, sexual deviance, it's not that it's bad in moral individuals, it's that there are actually types of people who are mentally ill, and it's not their fault that they're homosexual. And so at this period in the late 1800s and early 1900s, you see the definition of new categories of persons, right? The homosexual, the cross-dresser, all of these, there's a proliferation of categories in this Victorian era as scientists are just ceaselessly talking about sex and categorizing all the different ways of not fitting into the proper norms, the proper, what Dave calls, normative morality. They also have a long critique of prisons and surveillance. Also, interesting little tidbit, sexologists actually defined the concept of heterosexuality before homosexuality, but in the original meaning of heterosexuality, it was another form of deviance. It was people who were attracted to the quote-unquote opposite sex, but like too attractive. They were too thirsty. And it was considered deviant, right? So you have in this era this proliferation of terminology for different kinds of deviance. And these become associated with kinds of people. It's no longer an act of like two men having sex or two women having sex. Now it's an identity of the homosexual. Anyway, that was a little bit of a tangent, but it's an interesting tangent. Right, I was saying that the meme really draws our attention back to Sean Jay's critique of progressive dystopias and Simpson's critique of liberal multiculturalism. Because this concept of ethics that Sean Jay, I'm sorry, that Dave is working with is very much rooted in these in Foucaultian critiques of these narratives of progress and modernity. Foucault's big argument, right, is what we're seeing is not new forms of freedom, but rather new forms of social control, new ways of managing populations, of disciplining them, of ordering populations in order to be better incarcerated. Incarcerated both literally in prisons, but also in a kind of metaphorical sense by which Foucault means the ways in which we are subjected to social norms and our whole sense of who we are as people becomes defined and determined by these social norms, by these practices of defining categories of people in terms of deviance. So the first key concept that Dave is introducing in their ethnography is this concept of ethics. Now, to get at this concept of ethics, they're drawing on the scholarship of Foucault, who is a French philosopher. And I have a silly meme for you, right? Who would win the progressive narrative of modernity, which underpins mankind's faith in the structures which make up Western society, or Foucault, one baldy boy? The joke here, right, is Foucault is basically critiquing the narratives of progress, and the this construction of norms that underpin the structures of the quote unquote West. He's deconstructing those things. So it's a kind of esoteric Foucault joke, but apparently if you Google Foucault memes, you get shit like this, which is great. And considering Sean Jay's critique of progressivism, I think this is an appropriate link to draw between this Foucaultian understanding of ethics and Sean Jay's critique of progressive dystopias, or Simpson's critique of liberal settler culture, settler colonialism. So Dave is drawing on Foucault's distinction between juridical ethics and aesthetic ethics. I'll describe these in a minute, right? Great. So this production of different quote-unquote types of people is really the core problem in Foucault's thinking about ethics, right? Because, the way he talks about this is through the word of subjection. And subjection for Foucault has a double meaning. It means to be subjected to forms of social violence and domination, to be targeted by those forms of violence, but also to be made into a subject, being made into a type of person. For example, starting to see yourself as something that we now call homosexual, that we now call heterosexual, that we now call bi or trans. And the idea is through these kinds of forms of social control, that proliferate different types of being, we're doubly subjected. We're subjected to social norms or moralities, what Dave calls normative morality, and we are subjected through that normative morality. We come to see who we are as people in reference to these systems of domination. And so this is the first part of Foucault's concept of ethics, juridical ethics. Dave defines it as practices and techniques that work to more deeply inhabit law rather than undermine it. Now, juridical ethics are not inherently bad for Dave, right? She cites Sarah Mahmood, who has a really wonderful argument about the ways in which Egyptian Muslim women seek to inhabit the normative moralities of Islamic law as a kind of alternative to colonial forms of governance, colonial expectations and laws about the proper liberal subject. And so for Mahmood, seeking to properly inhabit Muslim law, spiritual law, is a kind of critique of the colonial project, of the liberal subject. Likewise, we see the same thing with Simpson, right? We see indigenous people, Mohawk people, who are insisting on their belonging within a Mohawk nation. And they're saying, we are members of this sovereign entity. We will travel on these sovereign the passports of these sovereign entities. And this effort to inhabit the spaces of Mohawk law more deeply is also a practice of refusing citizenship within Canada, within the United States, refusing the constraints of colonial law. So juridical ethics isn't inherently bad. Yet, in Dave's context, the context Dave is working with, she's particularly interested in the ways in which queer and especially lesbian activists subvert normative, heteronormative moralities in order to construct alternatives to what she would, in this quote, describe as inhabiting heteronormative law, inhabiting heteronormative moralities. So if judicial law, ju I'm sorry, if judicial ethics is about more deeply inhabiting law, aesthetic ethics is about undoing those laws. Now, this is a bit of a complicated point, but Dave gives us multiple ways for thinking about this process, right? And again, this is a process of critiquing heteronormative morality, or what in the previous quote Dave called law, and instead inventing new ways of being, inventing new ways of being, new ways of new kinds of social spaces, and creatively practicing these new kinds of norms. Foucault often talks about this as a practice of self-making, a practice in the same way that heteronormative law for Foucault is a practice of disciplining subjects, subjecting subjects, so that we start to see ourselves through these categories of the homosexual, the heterosexual, the et cetera, et cetera. For self-making can also be about cultivating other kinds of selves, cultivating selves that are able to be in relationship in other kinds of ways. So this is Foucault's concept of self-making, or aesthetic ethics. Dave describes this as rethinking the ethical in relationship to the self beyond identity and moral law. This is a lovely quote, right? Aesthetic ethics is an act of rethinking. It's an act of rethinking that is about rethinking the self in relationship to, I'm sorry, rethinking the self that's beyond moral law or heteronormative morality. But also beyond identity. It's actually not about, like, who am I as a lesbian person necessarily. I'll come back to that in a second. And so for Dave, it's a commitment to think differently, to ask new questions of oneself in order to analyze and surpass the limits upon what can be said and done. Aesthetic ethics is really about cultivating new ways of being. It's about cultivating new kinds of social possibilities, rather than more deeply inhabiting morality or more deeply inhabiting law. For Foucault, the emphasis is not on liberation from power, but on the imaginative labor of inventing heretofore unimagined possibilities. This is really subtle, right? Foucault was actually really critical of the mainstream LGBT movement, because for Foucault, basically, what activists had been doing was adopting these kinds of scientific discourses that defined deviance, that defined types of deviance, adopting this language like the heterosexual, the bisexual, the transsexual, right? Because historically, right, this is historical language. And then basically adopting these kinds of languages and coming to identify through them, through these concepts of subjection, right? Identifying as gay. And for Foucault, the important thing was not who are you as a person. It's not about discovering the secret of who you are, your underlying true self as a gay person. It's not about discovery. It's about cultivating new kinds of social possibilities that couldn't have been imagined beforehand. Now, this isn't quite as, I don't think in practice this is inherently as dichotomous as Foucault talks about, right? When I was a kid, we didn't have language for things like it, but for things like non-binary. And now, that's just so common, right? And I always wonder, like, if I had a word like non-binary when I was 10 or 12 or 13, my life could have been really different. And this is very Foucaultian in a way, in that these kinds of social categories come to be lived, how we come to inhabit these social categories as a power relation, right? And it's not that I think that I am this kind of true self, right, that is non-binary, and I somehow discovered this true non-binary self at the root of my being. Rather, the language, the discourse of non-binary identities allowed me to adopt hitherto unimagined social possibilities. It opened the field of social possibility in my life. And so this is relational. It's not about identity, it's about relationships. It's not discovering your true self as an individual, but rather what relations through homosexuality can be established, invented, multiplied, and modulated. Now, Foucault is using homosexuality in a kind of metaphorical and open sense, right? He's basically saying, how can we draw on these kinds of forms of subjection in order to live new kinds of embodied relationships, new ways of loving and fucking and being in relationship and friendship? Foucault is really into fucking friendship. I'm sorry, that's confusing in this context. Foucault is really into friendship, including platonic friendship, by the end of his unfortunately short life, right? But he's interested in the establishment, invention, multiplication, modulation of new ways of being in relationship with others. So this is the concept, this is the core of the way in which Dave is using ethical, or the, thinking through the ethical. And I have for you guys another Foucaultian meme. Foucault, another thing Foucault is famous for is this concept of discourse, right? Going back to the narrative about the history of sexuality, his work on the history of sexuality, his idea, right, is you have these scientific discourses, these new ways of talking and conversations that emerge within these authoritative fields of scientific practice. And these discourses are the means through which we are subjected in that doubly sense to power. Guys literally only want one thing, and it's fucking discursive. Also, if you were not convinced yet that Foucault is fucking gay, look at how he's sitting. This idea of the discourse is actually very central to Foucault's understanding of power, because for Foucault, power is not purely negative. It's also creative and generative, right? Discourses can be dominating, but they also provide the means through which we are able to come into being as social creatures and have social relationships. Power is always complicated and contradictory and multiple for Foucault. And so it's not about achieving liberation from these fields of power, but it's rather about finding new ways of existing in creative ways within these fields of power. You know, and you can talk about, use the word empowerment too, right? This is empowerment is another way of inhabiting power. Anyway, back to ethics. Dave says, I use ethics to refer to those practices that emerge from within subjections as a creative disruptive response to normalization. What they mean by this, right, they're using subjections in that Foucaultian double way. Subjection in the sense of forming this sense of subject formation, forming a sense of who you are as a person and how you you're like a subject, like the gay subject, the lesbian subject, right? Cultivating this sense of what it means to be a lesbian subject. But also this practice of being subjected to dominant discourses, subjected to what Dave calls morality or heteronormative morality. So ethics in this sense is about practices that emerge from normalization, that emerge from these violent acts of subjection, but they also creatively disrupt those processes of normalization. They emerge within these systems of power, but they also disrupt dominant moralities. By normalization, Dave means a narrowing of possibilities to conform to institutionally legitimized norms such as identity, community, national belonging, and the language of law and right. I love this idea of normalization as a narrowing of possibilities. You know, the mainstream gay rights movement seeks to normalize gay identity by, say, through claiming things like marriage equality and the right to serve in the military. We can die for the sake of killing brown queers in other countries. We can get married. And, you know, you have this process in which now you have queer business owners who call the cops on homeless queer youth because they're loitering on their corporate property. Right, this is all normalization. This is producing a narrowing of possibilities to conform to institutionally legitimized norms, institutionally legitimized morality. And so ethics then is a process of disrupting that normalization. It's about disrupting identity, disrupting the institutionally legitimized forms of identity, community, and belonging, of law and right. It's about cultivating possibilities otherwise. So this goes back right to that previous meme. How are we thinking about ethics as a practice of disrupting these kinds of normative formations of the liberal subject that we've been critiquing so far in this class, that Sanjay has helped us critique, that Simpson has helped us critique? That said, for Dave, ethics isn't inherently positive and norms aren't inherently negative. Ethics is about cultivating new norms, and there's a process of these creative, open spaces of potential, of possibility, that then over time solidify into the formation of new norms that can actually be exceedingly rigid. And those norms may also need to be disrupted in this continually ongoing process. So it's not that one is good and one is bad, but rather this language helps us think through the operations of power and the cultivation of new social possibilities. The second concept that Dave is really building off of in their work is this concept of affect. I have another meme for you. Affect is a concept drawn from the work of Deleuze and Guattari, who are two other French philosophers who I are very difficult to read. But the short version, right, is when most people talk about affect, what they're talking about is something that has to do with the body, the sensory, the emotional. Affect is often distinguished from language or symbols or signs, right? It's not about, affect is not about knowing something. It's not about being able to communicate something. It's about touch. It's about taste. It's about a feeling you have in your body. It's the way your body feels. Which means it's a little hard to pin down, right? Because how do we pin things down? We pin them down by putting them in categories, by putting them in languages, in language and signs, and fixing them in those categories. And affect is fundamentally about things that resist being fixed in those kinds of categorizations. Dave quotes Brian Massumi saying, "Affect is intensity, with intensity defined as a quality of experience that is yet inassimilable to sociolinguistic fixing." Right? So here, affect, to talk about affect as an intensity, right? It's a quality. It's not something we can pinpoint or define really, because it's not a symbol. It's not the same thing as the word cat or the word chair or the concept of, I don't know, E equals MC squared. Affect is an intensity, and as an intensity, it resists fixing within these sociolinguistic categories. It's that which can't quite yet be assimilated. And so when Dave talks about affect, what she's talking about really is this fundamental tension between that which is as yet inassimilable and that which has been assimilated into systems of categories, systems of norms, systems of fixed meanings. And this is again getting at this core problem of ethics that Dave is interested in. The kinds of practices that produce these new emergent spaces of possibility, of potentiality, and then the way those potentials get fixed and have to be disrupted again and again and again and again. So what I do in terms of affect and how I think about the concept of affect is I have these two simultaneous definitions operating at the same time in my brain. And sometimes I draw on one, sometimes I draw on the other, sometimes I draw on both. The first part is what I said about affect as having to do with the bodily, the sensory, and the emotional. Not necessarily the sociolinguistic or the symbolic, but the feelings and experiences and sensory experiences of our bodies. And the second is Dave's definition of of affect as a tension between the as yet inassimilable and the assimilated. That quality of experience that is yet inassimilable to sociolinguistic fixing. So in this slide, I've pulled out some of my favorite quotes in which Davy circles around the concept of affect, never quite fixing it, but evoking this kind of space of undefined potentiality, or as yet unassimilated potentiality. Open-endedness, right? Open-ended possibility. So affect is a realm of potential, a realm where opposites can coexist, where multiple potentials are imminent. Imminent meaning on the verge of coming into being. Activism begins then precisely as the virtual in the world, virtual in the actual world. The previously unthinkable that is now flickering, now a flickering possibility just on the verge of entering upon the world of norms. I just absolutely love Davy's language here, right? The virtual in the actual world, that space of possibility, that space of something that was previously unthinkable and is now just flickering into possibility. Not quite entered into the world of norms, not quite fixed into specific defined norms, but on the verge of that happening. And really thinking about that tension between these open-ended creative moments and the fixing of those moments, the cultivation of spaces that are defined by new kinds of norms. And she writes, how are dreams of possibility variously kindled and assimilated? What a beautiful, simple description of queer politics in Delhi. How are dreams of possibility variously kindled and assimilated? So I hope with this kind of language, right, Davy is giving us tools for thinking more deeply about the problems that Sanjay and Simpson have really exposed, and thinking also more about the kinds of techniques through which we can enact something like abolition, something like refusal and decolonization, something like queer politics, as this kind of space of dreaming possibility, or dreams of possibility that are variously kindled and assimilated. And again, for Davy, right, it's good when these dreams of possibility enter into norms, right? That's a space in which people are creating new ways of social interaction that are actually solidifying into new kinds of social practice. However, those norms themselves, as they get fixed, often require being disrupted again and again and again. It's not that one disruption versus norms are good or bad. It's that it's a cyclical process that is at the very heart of what Davy is calling ethical practice and queer activism. I also thought I might need to define queer. I'm not sure that y'all need this because y'all are a different generation than mine and you grew up on like Tumblr and shit where you're just, everyone's talking about this anyway. But Davy does have a specific definition of queer. Basically, queer for Davy is whatever is at odds with the normal, whatever is at odds with the dominant or the legitimate. So queer is really just a space of opposition to the dominant, to the normal. It's a horizon of possibility whose precise extent and heterogeneous scope cannot in principle be delimited in advance. Put this way, queer is the ethical aspiration of activism. So when Davy talks about aesthetic ethics, talks about affect, talks about queer, the queer, right, there's a way in which these concepts are playing in and supporting each other, helping her to name these kinds of emergent, imminent spaces, these fields of possibility and potentiality, just on the verge of entering into the worlds of norms, as well as this process of creative disruption, of invention. And so when Davy talks about queer activism in Delhi, she's saying it's actually not about resistance for the most part. Queer and especially lesbian activists in Delhi are not understanding themselves to be acting out a logic of resistance. Rather, it's a practice of invention. It's a practice of creating radical new worlds. And by a radical world, Dave means, and this is the third quote, skipping around a little bit on the slide, a radical world is a world that's always in process, linked through their shared existence in a field of possibility. To think of queer activism in this way enables engagement with the process by which it is, by what is possible, approaches its limits. So for Dave, queer activism in Delhi is not about resistance, but invention. It's the practice of creating radical worlds, and radical worlds are always in process, always in becoming. And what she's trying to get at through here is the kinds of, simultaneously, the limits of what is possible in the current moment, but also the things that are just, that were unthinkable yesterday but are possible today, and that maybe are unthinkable today but will be possible in the future. And how do we account for these limits of possibility, but also push them and expand them, create new fields of possibility? And as Dave says, without the invention of possibilities for pleasure and love, there can be little resistance and little to resist for. And so that's the heart of Dave's understanding of queer politics, queer activism in Delhi, is this kind of ethical process of creating new emergent fields, spaces of possibility and potentiality for new ways of pleasure, new ways of love. All right, here's my discussion questions. If there's something you want to talk about, go for it. Go take this in a totally different direction. I love it. If you need more structure, here's some questions that you might engage with. But this book has so many lovely quotes. You know, pull some out. Talk about them in class. Talk about them over the discussion forum. And also, I'm curious, you know, how do these concepts that Dave is giving to us, how do these help us think through the kinds of problems we were discussing yesterday or problems we're discussing in this class more deeply? How do they help us understand the issues that Simpson and Sanjay are putting forward more deeply? So, you know, go forth and critique, invent, and creative practice, y'all.